Hello and welcome. Very good evening. Welcome to the Sunday edition of the Urban Debate. I am Afrida Rehman Ali. We are going to first take you through some very interesting pictures that we have accessed from ground to actually show you the level of damage and destruction, the trail of destruction that has been left behind by this avalanche that hit the Chamoli district of Uttarakhand earlier today. The Chamoli district indeed was hit hard by nature's fury. The avalanche that hit the district is characterized by loss of life and property. At least 10 workers who were associated with the power projects that were underway in these parts have lost their lives. 10 bodies have been recovered. 125 others are still missing. Many of them, in fact, most of them, workers, laborers who were part of this power project. In fact, before we go into the details, let's bring you the 5 most devastating visuals that will explain and give you an idea of the magnitude of this natural disaster. Let's look at the visuals of the massive flood in Dhauli Ganga River first. The first pictures that you're seeing right now, these are in fact visuals of the massive flooding that happened because of the Dhauli Ganga River being in spate after a glacier broke off in Joshimath in Uttarakhand's Chamoli district. Next set of visuals that's on your screen right now is from Joshimath district, and that shows the avalanche in full fury hitting the Raini village of the district. This is one village that has been hit the hardest. These are the pictures from Joshimath district. The avalanche hit this particular village first, and also some reporting from the ground telling us, our reporter Mohit Bhatt also was telling us that there is one particular village that has been completely washed out. We are still to get inputs on what happens to the local residents, whether their bodies or whether their lives are accounted for at the moment, but that clarity hasn't come through. We only have got the numbers and the figures from the workers on the rolls in the power projects, and in that sense we know that 125 are still missing, but yes, the numbers could rise. Let's take a look at these visuals of the flash floods in Dhauli Ganga River that destroyed many houses situated on the river bank. You can just see the nature's fury there in front of you, and that's the kind of devastation that was caused by the Dhauli Ganga River. These are the pictures of the flash floods. Next on your screens, explicitly highlighting the aftermath of the glacier outburst. What you're seeing there is the damage left behind. This actually is the picture of what the glacier outburst has left behind. Major destruction, like I said, a trail of destruction left behind by the glacier. Now the chief minister tells us things are brought under control. The Bhagirathi River water levels are currently under control. So because of that, there is no further flooding that is being reported. The idea now and the focus now is to rescue those trapped and those marooned in vulnerable areas and to evacuate other areas potentially that would come under similar impact. So that is the prime focus at the moment. We are looking at different visuals that we have accessed from the ground. Lastly, visuals on your screen of a dramatic rescue operation being carried out at the Tapovan tunnel. The tunnel was blocked due to the debris post the flooding, with several people trapped inside. ITBP jawans can be seen pulling up those who were trapped. 16 have now been rescued. The avalanche hit the Chamoli district while work was underway at a power project in the Raini village of the Tapovan area. Let me welcome my guest this evening, Himanshu Thakkar, coordinator for the South Asia Network on Dams, Rivers and People. I also have Vivek Pandey, spokesperson of ITBP, with us this evening. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us here on this edition of Urban Debate. I want to go to you first, Vivek Pandey. You are someone who's associated with ITBP and probably you're the best person right now to give us the ground inputs of what you have gathered from the forces that are deployed on ground. ITBP is fronting the rescue operation. We were just showing those pictures of ITBP personnel there. high spirited at the moment, doing their best on ground to save human lives. That is what is the focus. But from your information, what can you share with us? The number of bodies recovered, the status of the rescue operation. Over to you, Mr. Pandey.
Today, at around 10 a.m. early in the morning, you can say it's a bright sunny day, and our Joshimath battalion was doing its usual duties on Sundays. There was a large sound, a voice which came from the upper reaches at 10 o'clock, and it was felt that something wrong has happened. Soon after this sound, our teams, three teams of consisting of some 300 men, including the mountaineers, some medical teams, and some of the rescuers, we sent to the location, and within 1.5 hours, our teams were on the spot. What have been primarily viewed after reaching at the location, that 150 people have been reportedly missing from that particular location. It is Rishi Ganga, Dholi Ganga area, from Reni village to Tapovan, which was completely washed away, and it was told that some 150 laborers and some locals were working in the vicinity where this flooding started all of a sudden. So primarily, it looked that the entire dam was washed away in a manner of few seconds, and due to that, all load of water that was reserved in that particular reservoir have come in a full ferocity, and from the very beginning, it never gave a single moment for the people who were on the banks or maybe near the river. There were some huts also, hutments also. There were some grazers also, 5-6, which were reportedly there near the river, were washed away. So when we reached there, we found that all the water has already gone downstream, and the areas of Joshimath and in around certain tunnels, there were tunnel number 1 and tunnel number 2, which were told that there were certain people who were feared trapped inside those tunnels. So we reached there and we started digging these snouts because the tunnel was of around 900 meters. And after 4 hours of continuous efforts, we were able to rescue 12 men from that tunnel. Three were critically unconscious, in an unconscious state. We provided them oxygen. Right now, they are at the district hospital.
Okay.
In the meantime, the 10 dead bodies were recovered from various places on the river banks. Various river banks till the Helang reservoir, which is another dam. There are a series of dams which have been constructed on the rivers of the Alaknanda and their adjoining rivers, that they are tributary rivers. But this is very surprising because in this season, in winter season, there are no such incident happened earlier, because cloudburst and other phenomena are mostly occurred in the months of rainy season, or maybe in the summers because of the snow melting on the upper reaches. So there may be a likelihood that this dam has been somehow destroyed, and it was destroyed in a manner that it hasn't given us a few moments to the people who were residing or were there for some certain construction work or something. But we responded in a very professional manner, and the home ministry and our senior officials are keeping a close look to the situation developing. We will be doing it the whole night operation. There is another information us that there is another tunnel, that is tunnel number 1, and we are doing our rescue operations over there also. We are digging the area, and maybe some 30 people are trapped as it is reported. So we will be saving more lives if we are able to actually dug the tunnels, snout this tunnel number 1. Some 150 people, feared missing. This rescue operation is going to stay. Means for a couple of days, we are doing our best. There are certain probable locations where there may be a likelihood that people are trapped. If there is a possibility to rescue them, then we will be doing so. But due to the now darkness is there since 7 o'clock, there is darkness, so there is some difficulty in that. So we have vehicles, we have certain light towers we are facing, generators and all. So this operation is going to continue overnight also, and more people will be sent for rescue.
Okay, the operation will continue overnight. Vivek Pandey there giving us a detailed understanding of how things unfolded. This is very important because, like we keep saying, there should not be any misinformation or rumors right now. I want to come across to you, Himanshu Thakkar, what you just heard about how this doesn't happen typically at this time of the year. Usually this kind of a flash flood or glacier, as most reports are calling it, happens because of snow melting in upper reaches or because of very heavy rainfall. What, according to you, as somebody who studies rivers and dams very closely, could be the reason for this? And when we say a glacier breakout, for the understanding of our viewers, if you could help us understand the phenomena, why such a thing can occur?
Right. The first notable thing about this tragedy is there is a tragedy within the tragedy, that, you know, after so many hours of this event happening, we still don't know from the official agency that what exactly caused this disaster, this flood in the downstream on the Rishi Ganga and then Dhauli Ganga and then Alaknanda. So that's the big tragedy. The Uttarakhand government said there was a lake, glacial burst. The NTPC, which is owning the Tapovan Dam, says that it was avalanche. Some others are saying cloud burst. So, you know, there is no clear clarity. And that's a big problem. In fact, this kind of information should have been available as a pre-warning rather than post-disaster information. But even that is not available. What we can gather so far is that there has been good heavy snowfall in the Rishi Ganga catchment area in the last week. And today morning, when the sun came out and it started melting, there was an avalanche. Avalanche is essentially flowing down of the accumulated snow on the hills, of the slopes of the hills. And when that avalanche brought down a huge amount of snow down to the a glacial lake at the bottom of that hill, that glacial lake is essentially, glacial is a mixture of snow and moraine, a lot of debris. And that solidifies in the winter, yes, and then melts in the summer. So when that avalanche snowfall fell into the glacial lake, that glacial lake is essentially, the walls are moraine actually, debris, and it broke. And then when it broke, the water not only accumulated in that small glacial lake, but also what fell down into it from the top of the hills also flowed down along with all the debris, and which created the flood first in the Rishi Valley, Rishi Ganga. Now, the point to note is that, you know, it is not entirely natural, yes, in the sense that first there is a barrage on the Rishi, there was a barrage on the Rishi Ganga which broke. Now, when it breaks, it yes, acquires greater power and mass actually. Then the next, there was a Rishi Ganga hydropower project, 13.2 megawatt hydropower project, which is an existing operating project, which again broke after a few seconds. And then there is a Tapovan under construction hydropower project, 520 megawatts of NTPC, which is funded by ADB, which broke. Now, each time this structure obstacles break, right, the flow acquires a greater power and greater debris. Mm. And so in that sense, it is actually a part of the man-made disaster, in addition to the creating the impact in the absorption capacity in the surrounding area. So, and then the problem is that even when the event started unfolding, this information didn't reach downstream area. It was Central Water Commission, which is supposed to monitor the flood forecasting, was not even forecasting. But when it forecast the flood, it said at Josimath at 11 o'clock,
okay,
the water level had breached the previous highest flood level of 2013. Remember, 2013 was a massive flood. But that flood level at Josimath actually,
yes,
breached,
yes,
by
absolutely,
no less than 3.11 meters at 11 o'clock today. Now, the point is, these dams are not supposed to breach even in okay, monsoon floods. But in this off-season flood, you know, which was supposed to be relatively small flood, even in such a flood, they breach. That raises another question, mm-hmm, as to why, how can they, should have breached at this location. Yeah.
Right. Right. So, you know, typically, like you also mentioned, this is a treacherous terrain. It is not unknown to such natural phenomena. What you are suggesting, and if I got you correctly, is that there should have been a template followed which could perhaps have restricted the damage. The downstream areas were not warned ahead of time. But I want to ask Mr. Vivek Pandey, do you agree that it is one thing, of course, that, you know, rescue teams are... Okay, please go ahead.
So one more thing, it is not that the first time this event has happened, avalanche related to leading to disaster in the downstream area. It has happened in the past also, in number of occasions, including 1968, 70, 1980s and so on. So it is not first time it's happening in Uttarakhand.
Yes. So, you know, from the two of you, at least one thing that I think you share your view that this has happened because in no time, in a matter of seconds, like Mr. Pandey said, these dams broke and that added to the ferocity of the water and that actually caused the maximum damage. But yes, the questions of whether this could have been averted and all, whether there could have been actionable inputs available, especially for a state where such natural calamities are common. Why didn't the inputs come in on time? That is a separate question we'll have to address, but I want to go across to Vivek Pandey to understand right now what would be the prime focus. You were saying very specifically that with the daylight fading, the rescue operation can slow down. You know, is there enough equipment available to handle the rescue operation after, you know, it gets dark?
Yes, because what we are focusing at right now is to see the areas where there are chances of people trapped, because whatever has happened early in the day is something which is in a matter of, you know, an hour or so, most of the water has receded. So if there is some happening that has happened, means some people have been reported to have been washed away, some hutments washed away, some dams washed away. So there will be some people, must be some people who have washed away in that floods. But there are certain areas which is said to be safer, but they are now under the debris, like the snouts of those tunnels, two tunnels. So we are focusing primarily onto this because the catalog or the roster which was there with the dams, who usually employs these laborers or the locals to go for the construction works, it suggests that there were more than 100 people who were working. So if we have rescued 12 people and there are again 30 people who are we are going to rescue, then there will still be more than 100 people. In the night time, what we will do is to see those areas where we can find those people. In the daytime, we have already had around 6 to 7 hours to see the entire area. And all the agencies are on the job, and the administration suggested and the NTPC suggested and other the local agencies suggested that these are the areas where you can go for your search. So we are focusing on these areas, and during night also, because it is very localized kind of thing. If you are digging a tunnel, means the snout of the tunnel, then definitely all of our boys and some agencies who are working there, some JCB machines are there. We are taking help from that. The vehicles lights and some, we have certain lights, improvisation also, and there are certain inflated lights, which we have with our RRCs, that is Regional Response Centers. So we will be using that. We have dragon lights also. So I hope that there are no such areas which are not been given care due to the darkness. But yes, due to, it is cold now, dark also. So there may be some slowdown we can expect. But we will push more and more people. And it is expected that during the night itself, we will be able to go into the tunnels, which is reported to have 30 people inside.
Right. Also, you know, I want to in fact also highlight the fact, Mr. Thakkar, here, that like you also said, since the Uttarakhand floods of 2013, there should have been some lessons learned and a template perhaps that could have been followed. I want to understand from you specifically that what are the immediate measures that should be taken, because the Chief Minister said that we have controlled the water level and now there is no further risk. But typically in something like this, do things recur, or is there a relapse, or can things really be controlled beyond a point?
The first thing is to, you know, fully get full information as to what was the cause of this flood in the from the whatever the location it started from, and what is the situation there. And is there a possibility of accentuating or further events such happening? So that's the first thing that needs to be done, because we still don't have full information. So we need to use satellite images, local information, avalanche studies and so on to find that out. You know, send out geologists, maybe mountaineers and so on. The second thing is that we need to, like you said, 2013 was the worst disaster. Now, one would expect that any such disaster, if we expect that to learn lessons. But if you want to learn lesson, you need to first have a credible, independent assessment as to what happened in that disaster, what were the factors that played its role, and that what lessons we can learn. And then how are we going to put those lessons into practice? Now, if you look for such a lessons and report for the 2013 disaster, it doesn't exist still. So we have, in essence, we have no way to learn lessons from that disaster.
Right. You and know, we always say that with the advancement in technology, there are satellite information that would help us predict natural disasters. We do, talk about these things, but when it really comes to these natural calamities, we haven't yet, like you said, even in this case, we don't know whether there were any inputs given ahead of time, perhaps not. Even if there were inputs, could something of this nature be averted? Now, there will be, of course, a lot of questions going further, but right now the immediate focus is to save lives. The ITBP, along with the NDRF and the SDRF, are working tirelessly on ground. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us, for helping us understand the situation on ground and the phenomena in general.